All right, a very good morning and a hello to everyone. Again, my name is Senthil. I'm the founder and CEO for ONS Bio LLC. It's my great pleasure to be presenting to you all today. I thank Professor Ramaswamy Kalyanasundaram for his kind gesture to give us this opportunity. And I also thank you all, members of his group and department, for taking the time to join today. I really appreciate that on behalf of myself and my team. Today, I'm going to be talking about the bioprinting as a powerful research tool and potential therapeutic platform in the context of emerging mega trends in science and healthcare. Beyond the basics of bioprinting, I'll also try to cover some exemplary real-life applications and case studies of Rokit's 4D bioprinting technologies from research labs, commercial industries around the world, and even from examples from the operating room. So, before I begin, I will be representing Rokit Healthcare, a South Korean pioneer and leader in regenerative medicine. Notably, Rokit Healthcare is the manufacturer of 4D bioprinters and organ regeneration platform technologies, namely in vivo 4D and 4D6, with revolutionary potential and applications in basic and translational research. And also important in the context of development of autologous cell therapies. It's worth mentioning that Rokit manufactures industrial 3D printers as well and offers genomics and single cell RNA services. Today's talk is part of an active outreach to researchers across the US, such as yourself, to educate and create awareness about the potential for bioprinting technologies to transform and advance their research. So this is done as a partnership effort between Rokit Healthcare, my company ONS Bio, based out of Cleveland, Ohio, as the sole distribution partner for US Midwest, and Indicate Technologies, based out of Santa Clara, California, as the sole distribution partner for US West Coast. I'm joined here today by my colleagues, Dae Lee from Rokit Healthcare from South Korea, and Chris Kamimura, you just heard, and Parker Bowmanberg from Indicate Technologies. Together, we make up a team of bioprinting and 3D printing specialists that you can always refer to for an on-demand support anytime. All right, let's begin. I want us to first take a look around and see what's been happening in the news over the last 2 years. So these five events that I'll be talking about and the mega trends that get us closer to the values for which there is a lot of attention on bioprinting and a lot of attention quite growing every day. In September 2018, as you see here in this slide, we saw the feature news of a boy who was living for 14 years with a new bladder made from his own cells and seeded with 3D inkjet machines into decellularized pig bladder as a scaffold. Now, this was a work done by the renowned pioneering tissue engineer and surgeon, Professor Anthony Tala, whom I'm sure many of you would have heard of. He's now the director of Wake Forest Institute of Regenerative Medicine. Now, this work and similar work by many others highlights the promise and potential for bioprinting of human tissues to transform medicine with far-reaching implications for organ transplants, cancer treatment, and many other possibilities, such as better ways to develop drugs and antibiotics and so on. So in July of 2019, the American Medical Association approved the reimbursement codes for 3D printed surgical models and tools. while these were temporary codes that will be tracked for 5 years until full official reimbursement, these are making the foundation for a clinical registry of patient 3D scan data and relevant 3D modeling, which is very likely to serve as a learning resource and tutorial, and also provides, more importantly, the much needed impetus for active implementation of 3D printing in the biomedicine. Later that year, in September, the United States Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, also announced that it will eliminate all mammal testing by 2035, becoming the very first federal agency to make a strong statement and commitment towards the transition to humane research while emphasizing the dire need to find alternatives to use of animals in research. In October of that year, Rokit Healthcare and a diabetic foot ulcer specialty clinic in India put the bioprinter in the operating room to create a streamlined process of skin regeneration for diabetic foot ulcers. Now, this new and alternative method for chronic wound healing, it promotes skin reconstruction using bioinks made from patient's own adipose tissue, about which I'll be talking in more detail later on. And it was printed into size-specific patches and applied directly onto wounds. These dermal patches integrated with skin through early onset healing, and Rokit's mission is to decrease the rate of amputation for patients with diabetic foot ulcer, DFU. So this is critical, especially given the fact that the 5-year survival rate of patients who have undergone amputations is lower than 5-year survival rate for many cancer patients. So last but not the least, in the most recent months of 2020, COVID-19 has changed everything about the way we live. And most notably, we have seen the pandemic disrupt the traditional centralized value chains in manufacturing. So when hospitals got cut off from supplies of masks and ventilators because factories were shut down or the supply chain was disrupted, 3D printing came to the rescue in some cases to manufacture these supplies on demand and on site. All right, so when we put all these things together, what's the take-home message? So from these global events and megatrends that we are seeing in biomedicine, it points to the fact that 3D bioprinting has the potential to directly react to decentralized demands from life sciences research, and it can serve as an effective medical strategy as well. So clearly there is a growing value for on-demand biomanufacturing, and bioprinting is quite relevant in the to the real world needs and mega trends that we are observing. So it is for this irrefutable connection to the real world that I'm here today to talk about the 4D bioprinting technology. For above reasons, it may be worth paying attention to how this technology is maturing to impact our research and healthcare workflows today. So, though bioprinting is getting a lot of attention in the mainstream research only recently, the origins of the technology go back nearly 2 decades. It's not totally in its infancy, as some would think. In fact, the number of publications around this technology has been growing exponentially since 2000, And today there are thousands of publications as a testament to the benefits and applications of this technology across tissue engineering, biomaterial development, and regenerative medicine. So here in this slide, you'll see a list of publications that are hyperlinked. There has already been a lot of evidence that the ideal choice and combination of cells and biomaterials for tissue-specific applications using bioprinting from this literature. So perhaps in the future, journal publications will start requiring data from 3D human tissues between the 2D in vitro cultures that we are all quite used to and the in vivo animal or animal model studies or human studies even. So it may serve more as a bridge study between the two. So you can only imagine that it's likely to become an important criterion for your research to move forward. One of the major challenges in medicine, of course, is not having a sufficient number of tissues and organs to replace the failing and aging ones in patients. So in that context as well, bioprinting of human tissues will be quite relevant. So the modern tissue engineering, as we know, aims to indirectly replace damaged tissues with man-made scaffolds that support cell growth. Bioprinting as a field is at the frontier of this technology, and because it is the only platform technology that can create these tissues and organs with applications in many different types of diseases that come with aging. There is already a lot of evidence about the ideal choice and a combination of cells and biomaterials that one can use for tissue-specific applications employing bioprinting. So what are the key components and what exactly is 3D bioprinting or 4D bioprinting? So bioprinting is, in simpler terms to define, is an additive manufacturing process in which cells, biopolymers, and growth factors are combined to create tissue-like structures that imitate native human tissues. Because these printed living tissues are often further incubated to have them proliferate, mature, and change over time and become functionally viable, there is an extra dimension of time here that makes more sense to add. So in that context, what is 3D printing or 3D bioprinting becomes transformed into a 4D bioprinting. So the 4D bioprinting technology consists of largely three components, as shown here: biomaterials, bioprinter, or the hardware, and then we've got the software, which is the design aspect of this whole workflow. Let's quickly review the biomaterial aspect of the bioprinting workflow. Unlike the traditional 3D printer, which uses hard plastics or metal and synthetic materials to create non-living structures, a 4D bioprinter uses materials that are biocompatible, biodegradable, and derived from natural and synthetic sources. Naturally derived biomaterials include collagen, gelatin, elastin, chitin, coming from the extracellular matrix of human or animal cells. And they also include alginate, sericin, or cellulose coming from seaweed, insects, plants, so on and so forth. Natural hydroxyapatite is something that can be harvested from mammalian bone. And then synthetic biomaterials are biodegradable polymers with enough strength and elasticity to mimic human tissues. And they have references of they use in FDA-approved medical devices as well, some of these synthetic materials that are listed here. Finally, you also have composites, which are often a combination of both the natural and synthetic materials to add or enhance certain mechanical or chemical properties. So these biomaterials can be, again, very soft, low viscosity hydrogels or hard biodegradable plastics. And when hydrogels are combined with cells for printing, then they get the name bioinks. The bioinks basically serve the function of similar to an extracellular matrix that you find inside the body. So they are basically they play the ECM role in tissue development, function, homeostasis. The same bioinks here also help you to protect the cells from any shear stress during the printing process, on top of the fact that they also provide nutrients, hydration, and overall physical chemical support. So when selecting biomaterials for bioinks, there are several key criteria, but they can basically be summarized into two broad categories. One, the bioinks should be able to extrude out of the nozzle tips and be able to be stacked layer by layer structurally with or without any post-printing processing. And number two, the bioinks should be biocompatible and they should uphold high cell viability. So there are these different properties, physicochemical properties of bioinks that become very relevant. Now let's talk a little bit about the hardware itself. There are various methods of bioprinting available today, such as inkjet-based bioprinting or laser-assisted and stereolithography methods. But among all of these, extrusion is the commonest method. As much as 70% of the bioprinting that you see happens using an extrusion method. And that's why we are going to be focusing mostly on this method here today for our talk. One key component of any bioprinting hardware is the print head itself. That should be able to print both hard as well as soft materials. So there are two ways that a print head can do this. One is to print a scaffold laden method where you can print hard matrix and on top of that lay the cells. And the other is the scaffold free approach, which doesn't involve any hard matrix. So another key component is also the chamber's ability to mimic biosafety cabinet, so that after all, when you print living cells, you want to make sure that they are in a sterile environment. So it is important to have those conditions inbuilt into the bioprinter. So to optimize cell viability and functionality under the stress of printing, the chamber should also have UV disinfection capability, HEPA filter, and some type of a bioreactor capability to provide the optimal environments for cells, such as the temperature or humidity control. Finally, the last component of bioprinting platform is the design, meaning 3D models of the objects we want to print. 3D model files, which are known as STL files, can be obtained either by manual creation using design software, or they can be derived from a CAD or MRI scan of a physical structure like human body or the tissue or organ type. So these STL files then get processed with a slicing software into a standard machine language that describes how a 3D printer should print the job in a given three-dimensional space. It includes information on the XYZ position coordinates, printing speeds, infill patterns, etc. The example images shown below here, you will see, show the difference between the different STL object and the G-code variations as visualized. Now that we understand the components of bioprinting, we can put together the bioprinting process logically. The process principally involves five key steps, and I'll quickly summarize. Number one, preparation. That involves designing the experiment with a clear identification of the problem to address. And it includes the selection of right biomaterials, cell types, 3D models that the printer will use. And the second step in the process is the printing itself, which is the actual printing process. The 3D models are sliced into appropriate printing instructions for the printer, and bio ink is placed in the printer cartridge, and a deposition takes place based on the digital model. Then we've got the post-printing processing, which may or may not be needed depending on the type of material we use. So basically, you take the printed structure and do a mechanical or chemical stimulation so as to create a stable and functional structure of the biological material. Evaluation is the step, and it's an important step, in which the cultured printer tissues are assessed for structural, morphological, functional characterization by comparing against any living tissue standards. And in terms of applications, applications involve making use of the bioprinted product for various purposes. And that could range from disease modeling to in vitro safety, efficacy testing, or the ultimate goal would be to use it as an in vivo tissue for transplantation. So just to make that point that we discussed a little more clear for us, what we can do is we can try to view this workflow in the context of, let's say, cardiac patch engineering. So let's take that as an example. In case of a cardiac patch engineering, it would look something like this. Preparation, printing, post-printing, evaluation, application. So you start with the ischemic heart disease, and then you go all the way down to the different applications. So I will let you take a look at this in the interest of time at leisure whenever you have the recording of this video. But I'm sure you get the idea. So the cardiac patch engineering that I just mentioned is just one example, or it's just one of the many downstream applications possible with bioprinting. Bioprinting has been used in departments across tissue engineering, material development, regenerative medicine, veterinary medicine, toxicology, pharmaceutical sciences, and so on. So for simplicity, I will summarize these different areas of applications into three broad categories. One is the in vitro efficacy test models for toxicological testing and screening of novel products, whether it be a drug or cosmetic or food. And this is especially important in the context of replacing animal testing. And number two would be the in vitro study model for human tissue physiology and disease model. And number three would be the in vivo model for transplantation and regeneration. So number one, the in vitro efficacy test models for toxicological testing and screening of novel products, whether, again, be it a drug, cosmetic, or food. An ideal study to evaluate the toxicity of a chemical substance to humans would require a large number of human subjects to be used to represent the diversity of humans. But in the real world, this is unrealistic and unethical to involve that many human subjects, especially when it is very early in the process of drug development. So the use of human relevant tissue model would offer a nice alternative and serve as a bridge between the human clinical trials and the animal studies with the standardized human tissue fabrication process and a high throughput specific deposition of test chemicals. So in that context, clearly bioprinting has a wonderful role to play. Second, in the in vitro study model for human tissue physiology and disease modeling, traditional science has always relied on 2D cell culture and 3D spheroids, but decades of research have shown human tissues are highly complex and they are heterogeneous, and structurally and mechanically and biochemically, they are very complex and heterogeneous. So the cancer or tumor is a great example of such complexity, and bioprinting's ability to fabricate and visualize or map tissues in 3D will enable us to near accurately understand some of these processes and the disease processes as well as physiology. And so as a consequence of that ability of being able to replicate the in vivo tissue, one can have the advantage to develop more accurate therapies. So clearly for tumor simulation, 3D bioprinting has a definitive role to play. Last is one of the important holy grail applications for bioprinting, and that is in the area of transplantation and regeneration, which may be of a lot of interest to your group, especially because of the fact that you focus a lot on stem cells. One of the most common challenges in medicine is, of course, not having the sufficient number of compatible tissues and organs to replace in the event of a trauma or an organ failure. So flat structures like skin and tubular structures like blood vessels and urethras, they may be relatively simple to fabricate, but hollow non-tubular organs like bladders and pumping organs like hearts and lungs are very difficult to replicate. So for such a highly complex organs to be printed, bioprinting technology provides a high degree of precision that surpasses a human hands or any manual effort. So if these could be, on top of this, if these could be made with patients' own cells, then the challenge of immune rejection and donor shortage that we see with organ transplantation today can be resolved once and for all. So this is a nice video that you would appreciate. This is a bioprinted cardiac patch that reads like the real cardiac tissue. And one can imagine that as an extension of the same dream of being able to print functional organs like the heart, it's also possible to perfect bioprinting in future decades, to the point where nanotechnology and smart material incorporation would lead to really smart organs that would have extended durability that would be unimaginable for any naturally occurring tissue or organ. So in the context of all of these, we have discussed so far about bioprinting, Rokit Healthcare is emerging as a key player in bioprinting and organ regeneration space through innovative products, services, and robust in-house R&D programs that are aimed at creating breakthroughs in science and healthcare. Rokit Healthcare is also dedicated to providing these innovative offerings to well over 25 countries and around the world, with over 250 user institutions and partners. As a pioneering leader, Rokit introduced the state-of-the-art bioprinter in vivo 4D, about which I will talk more later on. It was the first clean chamber incorporated bioprinter with HEPA and UV lamps when it was first launched. So I'll show more about these later on in the talk. But for now, let's go to the heart of today's talk, which is the actual applications as gathered from published work. So the slides in the following section that you will see are summaries of publications by Rokit's Dr. In Vivo 4D users. The goal of my presenting these data is to quickly give you the diversity of applications without going into too much detail, just because we don't have that much time. But if you do have any questions, please send them in the Q&A box so we can revisit them at the end of the presentation, or you can also feel free to write to us later on after the webinar so we can fill you in on the references and then also have more detailed discussions. All right, so let's get started with the first set of applications that are mostly in the realm of biomaterial research. I don't intend on going in any logical fashion in terms of the application, such as going from more low-hanging fruit applications to more complex ones. But the way this has been planned here today is to hit upon some of the keywords of research interest that Dr. Ram had conveyed to me. So I hope you would find some of these interesting and useful. So the first slide here shows that biomaterials are kind of the engine of tissue engineering. And so the technology of bioprinting has been playing a very big role in characterization and development of novel biomaterials. But in this particular study by Hanyang University of South Korea, a group developed a synthetic self-healing hydrogel called OHA, GC and ADH, which are basically hyaluronate and chitosan modified forms. So the great thing about this hydrogel is that it forms bonds instantaneously without post-gelation or additional cross-linking processes. So after cutting the gel into pieces, as you will see here in these two colored discs, the two colored discs made of this self-healing hydrogel quickly reassembled and integrated completely in less than 10 minutes at room temperature. It supported not only the viability, but also the functionality of chondrocytes, as seen by the expression of key markers like SOX9 and chondrocyte marker COL2, which is a genetic marker for cartilage differentiation at up to week 3 of culturing. So going forward, this group says that this self-healing hydrogel has the potential in cartilage as well as various tissue engineering applications and even time-dependent drug delivery systems. Here is an example of an application in nerve regeneration by printing a guidance conduit. So autogenous nerve graft is primary consideration for peripheral nerve defects. However, significant morbidity of the donor site is inevitable. In this study, the research group developed elastic nerve guidance conduits under using a nanoporous structure with material PLCL, which is polylactide co-caprolactone, and they rolled up the membrane with neutralized oriented collagen hydrogels that were printed using the Dr. In Vivo 4D2, which is the Rokit's bioprinter. In the in vivo study using the sciatic injury model in rats, the 3D printed nerve conduit, it exhibited denser and more organized myelinated axons than the group that was made with the bulk collagen hydrogel. So the aligned collagen hydrogels, clearly enabled by the 3D printing patterns, they appear to provide a preferable environment for nerve regeneration, providing a guidance path along the longitudinal direction. This is a study on the cancer application. In cancer therapy development, understanding the complex three-dimensional tumor microenvironments is critical. In fact, cancer was one of the very first fields of science to demonstrate that 2D cell culture cannot replicate what actually happens in the human body. So in this study, jointly conducted by Joong-Ong University of Korea and Wake Forest Research Medicine Center in the US, in vivo, again, the Rokit's bioprinter was used to develop a 3D human bladder cancer model. It was compared with the 2D model to evaluate the behavior of two types of cancer lines to two types of chemotherapies using rapamycin and BCG. As one could expect, the results of the chemotherapy test showed that different profiles of reactions, regardless of the cancer cell lines, whichever cancer cell line was used. Therefore, the conclusion was that using the 3D model of cancer is crucial to assess drugs' efficacy. So here we go one step further, and we look to combine, look at a study where they have combined more than one cell type. First, we've got a bioprinted layer of lung fibroblasts and the HUVEC cells in bioinks of alginate, fibrinogen, and gelatin. So this is adding layers of complexity. Then the multicellular tumor spheroids of glioblastoma cells are seeded onto the vascularized tissue, incubated, and that results in a usable vascularized tumor model. Just to touch upon a little bit of the bone and cartilage tissue, the heart tissue, although autologous bone grafts are regarded as gold standard for restoring bone defects, however, for large dimensional bone defects, there is a need for an alternative method to autologous bone grafting, which, although effective, can cause other new problems like the donor site morbidity and low graft availability. So for this reason, the bioprinting in this case has been explored actively to fabricate bone regeneration scaffolds using synthetic bone materials such as hydroxyapatite, which is a very common bone engineering material. So in this particular case, the bioprinting was used to develop an entire customized bone implant manufacturing process in a GMP condition using the hydroxyapatite, PLLA, and the beta TCP. And it also received approval of the for distribution by the Korean FDA, US FDA equivalent agency. So this is an excellent example of the bioprinting platform commercialization potential. So in this study, what we see here is the synthetic hyaluronic acid was reinforced with strontium, a metal ion that allows pure hyaluronic acid to dissolve better and induce optimal formation of bone tissue in the early stage of implantation. For the first time, the strontium incorporated HA, which is a bioceramic scaffold. It was printed with the 3D printing technique using the in vivo 4D. And in vitro bioactivity tests demonstrated that the scaffold, the printed scaffold, strontium incorporated scaffold, it promoted rapid cell proliferation, osteogenic differentiation, and the cellular mineralization. This is a particularly interesting study where that's done in as a joint research between Rokit Healthcare's internal R&D and the Mass General Hospital in Boston. This is a study involving preclinical testing for cartilage regeneration using stem cell-laden bioprinted matrices in cartilage defective models in beagles. And the results so far have been very encouraging. Quantitatively speaking, we have seen the localized hyaline cartilage regeneration in the knee area. And we have also qualitatively seen that the beagles are able to actually walk. There was a recovery in their walking functions. This is a set of studies to focus on the stem cells. The biggest problems with the conventional methods of culturing adipose stem cells includes the difficulties in controlling the mass production and the stemness and the maintenance of the stemness. So in this study, the research group used in vivo 3D bioprinter to create a novel hydrogel-based manufacturing platform called the HES, as in hydrogels with an embossed microstructure, which is capable of culturing a large amount of stem cell spheroids. With bioprinting, the group was able to print even layers of hydrogels seeded with spheroids. And the sizes could be easily controlled by a cell, by this cell seeding density. So within the 3D bioprinter construct, the spheroids demonstrated excellent retention, anti-apoptotic, and pro-angiogenic properties. The group also demonstrated better osteogenic, chondrogenic, and adipogenic differentiation than 2D cultured stem cells. Accordingly, the spheroid production using the HES could be used in various fields, including cell therapy and possibly ex vivo tissue reconstruction. To focus our attention on a little bit of the soft tissue printing, in this particular study, I'll quickly indicate that this was done in Seoul National University. A research group sought out to engineer a novel way to regenerate adipose tissue. And the conventional medical grade material, such as PCL, are often used in breast reconstruction, nose reconstruction, but they do not match the mechanical property of the adipose tissue. So the group first developed a novel biomaterial called PLCL and mixed it with adipose-derived ECM. Using the bioprinting technology, the group then created a size customized scaffold, which when implanted onto a mice, promoted adipose tissue regeneration with macrophage infiltration and noticeable vascularization. So the group also confirms that bioprinting combined with new PLCL ECM complex offers a new solution for burn, trauma, injury, and post mastectomy repair, especially in large defects. The group at this work is done by the group at Seoul National University, and it was developed where they developed a novel hyaluronic acid catechol coating platform for effectively growing a functional salivary gland. So they call this platform the niche. It combines hydrogel coating technology with 3D printed porous PCL scaffolds to demonstrate that the highest amount of salivary gland tissues were formed compared to a non-coated one. And so using these, using all non-coated ones, using the traditional membranes of soft agarose gels. So the results clearly show that a good vascular endothelial cell growth happens in this printed scaffold. So the group is also looking forward to applying this platform to create better human models, particularly for branching epithelial organs. Okay, so this is about the beating model engineering, which I'll cover in the next three slides. These are to create cardiac tissues. This particular study is from the Italian group, and they have created in vitro models of human pathological cardiac tissues using bioartificial scaffolds. So here in this study, the group uses different patterns of PCL scaffolds to create tissues that mimic different electromechanical properties and therefore different stages of the progression of ischemic heart disease can be observed. So in this, this is a case study where the cell suspensions of muscle cells are printed around two PCL pillars of customized shape to create muscle models for drug testing. This is also of interest probably for some of you. Quickly, bioprinting is also opening doors to a novel QR coded drug system, drug delivery system. And in this particular example, as you can see how thin this is, these are thin oral dispersible films that support patient compliance because they are not only easy to swallow, they also are highly informative because of the QR code. They deliver the information about the patient's prescription right upon scanning of the drug itself. And this could both reduce the misconsumption and misadministration of medicine. So in fact, there is even a growing trend these days in among the pharma companies to replace anti-cancer injections with oral dispersible films as a better and effective way to minimally invasive therapy. So lastly, I want to touch upon the ability of bioprinting to not just print mammalian cells, but also to be able to print devices. So here the bioprinting has been used to develop an egg-shaped bioresponsive device that combines microbes, hydrogels, and conductive carbon nanofibers. So this platform offers an improved method for culturing and monitoring microbial cells and their metabolic activities in a confined, organized space. So among the unique advantages of 3D bioprinting, the ability to inject microbes and carbon nanofibers at desired positions in desired locations, it can prove very useful since this group could position the target cells and gather their desired responses in a controlled environment. So the research group that did this work also suggests that the microbial bioresponsive device that they printed here can be a very useful tool for studying wastewater treatment, microbial biosynthesis or metabolism or processes like photosynthesis as well. Lastly, in terms of the device, I have to mention that with bioprinting, researchers have created wrist-wearable thermal therapeutic device. This is a great example of the extension of the capabilities of the bioprinter for device printing. So in this case, a wrist-wearable device from a mix of nanocellulose and thermoplastics was 3D printed to fit perfectly onto the patient's body. The device has applications in heat-based clinical treatment or insulated clothing. And reversely, it can also be removed to remove the heat, and it can be made cold. Or to make it cold. So that is an application that can be used as a stealth sheet that can make objects invisible at night. So a lot of interesting and fancy things possible as well. Okay, so that concludes the quick application overview, but the most important thing is the most important applications for bioprinting are not at the bench, but about the applications that go into the clinic. So in the next set of slides, I would like to give a case study example done by Rokit. And diabetic foot ulcers, they represent one of the biggest debilitating diseases in the world. And India as a country is struck hardest by this disease. So last year in India, Rokit Healthcare did the world's first clinical study using bioprinter in vivo to regenerate skin in diabetic foot ulcer patients. So the solutions were that they present are kind of summarized in these slides below. So leveraging patients' autologous cells with bioprinting technology, Rokit's scientists and partners in India were able to develop patient-specific, site-specific treatment with no immune rejection. The results were very encouraging, and it took on an average 4 weeks to close the wounds that had otherwise stayed open for months to even years. So many such studies sponsored by Rokit are actually already underway in US and Turkey as well. And their vision is to use this therapy to be applied to many other skin indications, including burns, scars, and bed sores. So all of that leads to the idea of an integrated 3D scan print therapy, which would take the patient's image and translate it into a personalized regenerative solution at the bedside. So this is better explained in this video of how this entire process proceeds. This short video here, what you see here is just a silicone model. The wound area is scanned, the organ is scanned, and then the precise the design for the filling of the wound is mapped out. And this is an actual Rokit developed software that was used for the Rokit study to scan the patient's wound and then be able to direct the bioprinting to fill the wound and provide the therapy. So here what you see is after the wound is scanned, the wound is measured, and then that leads to the printing process, printing the scaffolds, and then quickly also using the bio ink and the patient cells, the wound closing patch is printed. And here is the transplantation of the wound on the of the printed patch onto the wound in an operating room. All right, so that brings us to the last few minutes of our talk, where I'd like to take the opportunity to go over the in vivo 4D2 and 4D6 bioprinters quickly. There are, as you can see from this chart, which is not exhaustive, there are many, many institutions across the globe, including many US institutions that currently have 4D, in vivo 4D bioprinter made by Rokit. And this is over 250 different users across 25 plus countries. So the first, in 2016, the first bioprinter that was launched by Rokit is called the Doctor In Vivo 4D, and now it's renamed as 4D2. This, when it was launched, this was the first and only desktop bioprinter to have the germicidal UV and HEPA clean chamber incorporated into the bioprinting design. Many others were printers without these features, and they had to be put into a biosafety cabinet. But this was a standalone biosafety cabinet in itself. There are over 200, as I mentioned, 250 references already available, establishing the use of bio in vivo for some of the published work. 30 plus publications in many internationally recognized journals. And to tell a little more about the 4D in vivo bioprinter is has the multiple printhead system here to handle many different types of materials, the syringe dispenser for bio inks, powder mixtures, and hydrogel printing. We've got the filament extruder. We've got the pneumatic hot melt dispenser for pellets, powders, and paste, requiring very high temperature ranges. The print head has a very notable range of -5 degrees to 350 degrees, which is very high, which is a very broad range compared to many other competitors out there. And the printer is made of quality assured hardware with the aluminum base, not plastic, for durability. And it comes with a complex biofabrication software that is very easy to use, that provides ability to control over 40 plus parameters. So since the launch of InVivo 42, based on a lot of from talking to users, researchers, and clinicians, Rokit has really listened to the feedback and with in line with their vision to bring more of the bioprinting applications from bedside to bedside, they have put together in some of the key improvements to the unit that involves addressing some unmet needs. Well, for example, you could imagine that the human body is a curved surface. So there is a definite, if we have to use and apply the bioprinting to therapies, it is important to be able to directly apply biomaterials to a curved surface of the body to create or repair living tissues. And that should be made easy and possible. And so that calls for in situ 4D printing. And when we deal with therapeutic approaches, it is important to treat all substances as potentially infectious. And so any device meant for that purpose should be able to sterilize itself as well as an implantable device that it creates. So focus on sterilization. And lastly, it is important to realize that the mammalian cells, they grow best at their native conditions of temperature and in vivo pH, similar to the carbon dioxide tension in the bloodstream. So high humidity prevents evaporation of growth media. So all these parameters, they work together to keep the cells happy. So Rokit decided to combine the existing bioprinting platform with the incubator and sterilization functions to create the organ regenerator capable of a Z-axis curved printing, the first of its kind, and complete sterilization UV HEPA filter with a hydrogen peroxide plasma sterilizer and an incubation system to maintain optimal temperature and carbon dioxide controlled printing. So that led to the solution, which is industry standard defining InVivo 4D6. So this is the most recently launched system. It comes with 6 print heads that can handle many different material, many different possibilities to print fine structures. And so the capabilities to print very complex architecture, similar to what you find inside the body. And this is to give you a quick example of the print in progress, because lately the COVID in-person demos are becoming difficult or impossible. So hopefully you will get an idea of how this printing works. And also the InVivo 4D6 has the ability to, as I mentioned, handle the human cells and tissues because of very well compared to many other printers out there because of the incubator sterilizer function that's inbuilt into it. And it also has the ability to print in a high throughput format up to 384 well plates. So this is particularly important in the context of being able to develop using the bioprinting approach in drug development or vaccine research or a whole bunch of other things. And lastly, because of the varied types of print heads available and the huge range of temperature and pressure capabilities, it can handle both soft, hard materials. So a wide array of biomaterials can be put into this bioprinter to create really complex structures. So this hybrid technology and automation, all that kind of ties into being a very robust and powerful system that has the potential to be cGMP ready and kind of take the research at the bench and the innovations quickly into the clinic, which is kind of where all of us want to see innovations happen. And this is to quickly give you an overview of the user interface that comes with the InVivo 4D6. In the interest of time, I'll just quickly scroll through. It is very intuitive, easy. So the printer can be controlled using onboard PC, or it can be controlled through a laptop or a mobile device such as a phone or a tablet. Okay, so to conclude, the take-home messages for today's talk. So at the end of the day, that's very important. So bioprinting brings three breakthrough benefits to research and novel therapy development. One is automation, faster and precise, then physiological relevance of the printed tissue, and the ability to do on-demand fabrication. So these breakthroughs, they result in the ability to experiment with better repeatability and better physiological relevance, ability to generate biomimetic structures and tissues without having to depend on model systems that are either too expensive or not ideal. And lastly, the ability to create more sustainable research methods that can eventually help us phase out animal models with an alternative human cell-based method of testing. And it's possible for us to imagine that in future or in the near future or far future, that the bioprinting facilities would be set up in every region of the world. And the technology itself has the potential to completely transform regional biomanufacturing value chains, just like how the COVID-19 made us realize that is still relevant to our modern day. So it's not surprising that, in fact, some of these bioprinting centers are already in existence across the world. There are already many of these existing, and many more already on their way to be set up, both at national and international levels, to focus on the transformative potential for regional biomanufacturing driven by bioprinting technologies. So lastly, I'd like to leave you with this message of that we all live in an era of regenerative medicine. And in this era, bioprinting is not only a revolution that's underway for the way we create and use model systems for research to answer basic biological questions, but it is also revolutionary in the way that you practice medicine. Instead of using the systems that and medical practices that have heavily relied on treatments of symptoms using small molecules or monotherapies, bioprinting and associated technologies, tissue engineering, they are shifting the focus towards harnessing body's own healing potential that's inherent in the stem cells. So I'd like to thank you all for sharing the passion and the willingness for innovation by participating in this seminar today and giving me and my team the opportunity. I'm very encouraged by your group's interest and plans to purchase or adopt this technology soon. I will take some questions now. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you, Santhiels. So I think I don't see any questions in the chat room group, but I believe everyone has the ability to unmute and ask a question.
Thank you, Santhil. I had several questions that you did answer in your good presentation. So it's excellent. You covered most of the areas that I had. Couple of questions I have is, how do you, can you able to see these cells while it is printing? Do you have a microscope or a camera or anything in there that you can visualize?
Yes, I forgot to mention, they come with a camera. You can't see the cell, but you can see the printing, the printed structure. The cells obviously are too small for the camera, but there are thoughts and plans about incorporating a high resolution scope into the print head in the subsequent versions, if that's what the users need. But the usage or incorporation of any of those microscopic elements to the print head would not be needed because if the goal is to use them as an analytical system to see or assess the quality of the cells, because it's very hard when they are mixed with the bioinks to really discern what is cell and what is not. But to monitor the progress of the print, there are cameras inbuilt and also positioned on the side, depending on which model you're looking at.
And the second question I had is, typically what is the percentage viability of your cells after it has been printed?
Okay, that's a good question, but it's quite variable. There are many publications that show the viability is not affected significantly, meaning there are cases of more than 90%, 95% viability post-printing. Now, that simply varies on what choice of bioink you have and what optimizations you do and the different cell types. Some cell types, they simply may not tolerate, but some will. But generally, that is not a primary concern. More than the structure or the shape that you're trying to.
If you're printing, you want to make sure that the tissue grows properly.
Because if you think the nozzle size we use is not too narrow. Generally speaking, it's about 200 microns, and so most mammalian cells would be comfortable within that range.
So how do you cure the tissue? Do you use the UV or?
Yeah, so there are multiple ways in which you can do the curing, either through chemical methods or through UV, depending on the type of bioink that you use. But for the cells and the viability, definitely the UV won't be the best option. But there is a lot of literature out there for different materials, different combinations, things that have been already tested. And having said that, there is always going to be a little bit of a optimization and learning curve for each project and each user to kind of standardize things for their own projects. There is room and scope. But to that point, I also want to say, RoKit as a company, the way you can think about them is not just as a printer manufacturer who just sells printers. They are more a well-rounded regenerative medicine company. And so by that, what I mean is they have a robust R&D that always is willing to share some of their expertise in-house and also among the user base in a format that you can use to design your own experiment. And they are willing to support and help you with all that input as you go about doing your experiment.
Sure. In one of your slides, you did show that in the heart, you can actually print the blood vessels and also the tissue. So that was one of my questions also. If you wanted to have let's say the cancer, steroid, if they're printing, can they also print the capillaries in there and print epithelial cells to that one, around that actually the cancer cells, to have both kind of two different types of tissues with a different scaffold in there?
Yes, you can design, but in terms of capillaries, let me check if my colleague is there. Dae?
Yep.
Dae, okay. So let me first finish answering this to the best of my capability, and I'd like you to chime in, okay?
Yep.
So in terms of being able to print multiple tissues or say to incorporate blood vessels into the structure, that's it is not the design problem is easy. That can be done. The choice of the right material and the actual logic of going about doing that might need some optimization and work to be done. Fine capillaries, I don't think those are printable, because they could be really smaller and we may not have the resolution, even though the printer itself has a pretty good resolution for handling cells. So as structures like finest of the capillaries may be a challenge. But I'm sure there will be some new ideas in the community that might also address those problems. Dae, your thoughts?
Yeah, so from my experience with bioprinting publications in the journals today, two of the most commonly used methods for creating vascular networks with the bioprinting technology can be summarized into the following. So the first one is the idea of using sacrificial inks. And basically the idea is that you create some type of channels with an ink that is later going to be sacrificed, meaning it's later going to be dissolved within a gel that contains the cell types for creating the, let's say the model is the heart, then we have the muscle cells in a material like gelatin that is supposed to harden at a certain temperature, but the sacrificial ink that was used to create the channels inside will dissolve at a temperature where the gelatin hardens. So then you're left with these empty channels, which then you can perfuse using like a microfluidic device connected to the bioprinter to create these vessel-like channels. Of course, like Santil said, the challenge is to get to the very tiny resolution that capillaries would represent, which is challenging today with extrusion printing, but at least you can still get the vasculature like networks using the skill that I've just mentioned. And another way is I've seen researchers actually create spheroids with the HUVAC cells. And they basically combine those, I would say, like blood cell, like spheroids with other types of cells. So in the case of a heart patch, they would combine cardiac fibroblasts with the HUVEC spheroids. And they take these chunks of spheroids and mix them with a bio ink, like alginate, for example, one of the most commonly used elastic nature hydrogels. And then they directly print these chunks of spheroids in a hydrogel onto a hydrogel patch, and that becomes the model for a rather simpler model for vascularized heart patch. So I've seen those two being explored today in the bioprinting world.
That'll allow the natural growth of those
endothelial
tubes. Okay. So I was thinking if there's anything like the biodegradable tubes that you can create and allow the endothelial cells to grow over. But that's perfect. So. I think we have people working with cornea. I think you didn't mention, so it must be possible to print the problem, right? Retina and cornea.
Yeah. Cornea is when it comes to the eye, definitely there are more applications on the cornea than the retina, but when it comes to the cornea, as long as you're using gels that are both printable as well as structurally, have structural fidelity, you are able to print that, you know, the curved, the curved structure of a cornea to mimic the tissue. And some of the most commonly used hydrogels include alginate and gelatin and collagen, and most of the times these are composite bio inks because they provide the ideal biocompatible environments as well as providing an elastic environment for this particular type of tissue.
So here again, actually, one of the researchers is trying to look at the growth of the blood and trying to find a drug that will prevent that growth. So basically, trying to find something for retinopathy, diabetic retinopathy. And so that's why I asked that question also, if we can grow the blood vessels there and then see if that on the growth will be something that she'll be studying as well. Okay, I will leave it for others if they have any questions.
Hi, Dr. Senthil. Okay.
Oh, it's okay, Vishal.
Dr. Senthil, it's a nice presentation and really helpful. So I have one question. What is the droplet speed? Like, what's the speed of printing?
I can answer that for you.
Yes,
so
yes.
We talked about two systems, 42 and 46. The 46 has a maximal speed of 50 millimeters per sec, whereas the 42 is 20 millimeters per sec. And of course, when I say millimeters, we are measuring the quantity of the length of bio inks or filaments that would be coming out of the nozzles per second. And for bioprinter devices, especially the extrusion-based bioprinting devices, most devices fall within the range of 20 to 30. But with the 46, we have upgraded the speed to up to 50.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Lee. And one more question is, is the device upgradable? Like, you said like there will be few additions which will be coming afterwards, or the software what you will be providing, is those like hardware and both software are upgradable or it's not?
Yeah, for sure. Definitely. But I mean, bioprinting as a technology is a constantly evolving technology, and we try to accommodate as much of the feedback we get from users to upgrade the hardware and software. I want to first mention that each of the systems that we talked about, 42 and 46, are actually broken down into three configurations for each of them. So basically, think about having six systems total, and each one of them is upgradable to the next. So for example, 42 has we didn't go into details about the devices because we just wanted to focus on the applications, but 42 has three configurations that can be upgraded from standard upgrade to premium. and then 46 has the same. So if you have specific research needs that, for example, don't require certain features at the beginning, but later on you end up needing more features, then yes, you could upgrade one configuration to the next. But then if you're talking about additional features being added to the system, for example, you want certain info patterns created into the software, or you want, you know, you want to perhaps change the wavelength of the UV light on the system than the default, then we can accommodate those personalized requests as much as possible. And the two things that I just mentioned are definitely doable on the systems.
Thank you.
Another question was about the software. If there are there upgrades and releases that come out?
Always.
Yeah, always. Softwares are constantly upgraded to, especially to include slicing parameters that open up more door, more options for you to manipulate your, you know, G-code instructions, basically. So when I mentioned the info pattern, that's what I meant. Like, for example, we may have a default set of info patterns built into the software. But if you are looking for particular patterns or particular ways to rotate the angles at which the info patterns are created, just because that's how, you know, human tissues are structured, then we could consider including those specific info patterns into the software, or we can even have our engineers create the G codes for you.
Okay, thank you. And yeah, one last question I have is, so you guys do have bio ink or cell materials available, right? Okay, yeah, and because we are new in this system, I just wanna know, like, if we are designing something, will we have a support available of the scientist? If, say, for example, I work on colon, and if I want, if I'm designing something, I might need more help in doing it and while the starting, or I may need some specialized bio ink, which may not be available. So yeah, I just wanna know, like, is the support always available or it's limited, like?
Yeah, so first of all, like, my position at Rocket Healthcare, actually, if you take a look at my title, I'm not only a, you know, like a bioprinting application development manager, but I'm a bioconsultant, meaning that people like me are supposed to provide these types of support to our users when they first get started on using the system. So in short answer, yes, we are there. Basically, every user is matched to at least one bioconsultant at Rocket Healthcare to help out with the process of doing experiments with the bioprinter. Of course, you know, you guys know best, each researcher knows best about their own field of research, and we may not be the, you know, the guru for answering every question about doing research, but we are able to take knowledge from our existing user base about the choice of materials, about the types of designs that perhaps have already been used and maybe you want to take advantage of, etc. We can even connect you to the networks of users we already have that may be doing similar research as you. And that way we can definitely provide support. When it comes to bioinks, I actually want to mention that we have a service called the ECM generation service. There is a technology called Humatine, basically creating whole native ECM from human cells, human cell lines. And so what this service does is, if you choose a type of cells, we can create ECM using cell sheet engineering technology from the cell type that you provide to us, or that you guide us to use. So That type of biomaterial might be useful for you because it's not just one component of the ECM, which is what a lot of bioinks in the market today actually give to you, like collagen or alginate or elastin. These are all single components, right? But the ideal tissue engineered method should combine all of the matrices and components in the native ECM. So we try to provide that service for our users as well. And it does have an extra cost to it because it's a personalized biomaterial development service, but it can be definitely specific to your tissue of interests.